So let's bring in our panel now. We have CNN political analyst David Gregory, CNN senior legal analyst and former federal prosecutor Jeffrey Toobin, and CNN legal and national analyst and former FBI special agent Asha Rangappa. Great to have all of you. Jeffrey, help us understand, what does it mean that the FBI agents were able to go to a FISA court and get two warrants to wiretap Paul Manafort?
Right. The FBI has units, as does the Justice Department, that do nothing but national security matters. And they go to a judge and say, we have probable cause to believe if you approve this wiretap, you will get we will get information related to violations of national security.
That's what Ashley said. Probable cause was.
No, but we do know that these are generally very voluminous documents filled with evidence. Some people accuse these FISA courts, Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act courts, of being rubber stamps. But you can be sure, with someone as high profile as this, a judge would have been very careful. They approve these judges, whoever, we don't know the identity of the particular judge, approve these warrants twice. And that suggests there is some evidence that Paul Manafort was involved with foreign intelligence. Doesn't mean he's guilty of a crime, doesn't mean anyone's guilty of a crime, but it's not nothing. And it shows that this was a very aggressive investigation, even before Robert Mueller was appointed.
And particularly the second time, you think the judge would have a high bar before approving such an investigation. Asha, the one thing we know today that we didn't know yesterday is there are tapes. There are tapes of Paul Manafort having conversations of what? We don't know. But there is that concrete evidence out there right now. And we know, because of the New York Times reporting also, that Paul Manafort was told by investigators that he's likely to be indicted. What does that all say to you?
Well, there are obviously tapes. So the FBI was monitoring him. And any kind of communications that are picked up with regard to this idea that any communications with President Trump himself could have been picked up, that is true. Those would be called incidental communications. But it doesn't mean that the president himself was being targeted. And unless there was any connection between those conversations and the foreign intelligence being sought under the order, those would actually be screened out of any kind of communications that the FBI would monitor. Now, if they were relevant to the Russia investigation, they would be looked at. The indictment piece, I agree that there's probably some pressure being put on Manafort to give more information. I think in this kind of case where it's an underlying counterintelligence investigation with these criminal prosecutions potentially coming out of it. But the primary threat here is the attack on our democracy by Russia. And so what they want information on are the Russians and how they did it and who helped them. So they're going to use any leverage that they have against Manafort to get him to talk about that if they believe he has information.
So, David Gregory, CNN has this exclusively, this reporting, this bombshell that he was actually wiretapped twice. But the New York Times has a little bit of color about what it's been like at Paul Manafort's house while this investigation has been going on, and just the tactics that Robert Mueller's investigators have been using. Here it is. Manafort was in bed early one morning in July when federal agents bearing a search warrant picked the lock on his front door and raided his Virginia home. They took binders stuffed with documents and copied his computer files. They even photographed the expensive suits in his closet. The special counsel, Robert S. Mueller III, then followed the House search with a warning. His prosecutors told Mr. Manafort they planned to indict him. What do you see here?
Well, I think what's so significant about that, as Jeffrey has pointed out earlier this morning, you don't normally see search warrants being executed in these kinds of cases. So it shows a level of aggressiveness on the part of the FBI prior to the special prosecutor and now with the special prosecutor. It also makes clear that the original act here, the attack on democracy, the interference in the election, that is primarily what they're after. Whether there was contact between top Trump officials and any Russian officials trying to manipulate the election. So we've seen several layers of this. There's an investigation going on into financial ties between those close to now the president or the Trump enterprises and Russia going back some time. There's also the investigation into actual contacts and the idea of some kind of obstruction of justice by the president that the president's own counsel have been arguing so strenuously about. So you have all of these things moving simultaneously that shows you the depth and the importance and the aggressiveness of the investigation and the fact that we know some facts about all of this, that Russia did certain things, that as a candidate, President Trump was talking about and inviting Russia to hack into the DNC's emails, to get those emails that were destroyed by Hillary Clinton, inviting a crime, inviting interference in the election. He's been less than truthful, as have people close to the president, about contacts they've had with Russians. So there's a lot there, and that's just in the public sphere that we are reporting on. We don't know to what extent they're actually close to indicting Paul Manafort, whether they're pressuring him or maybe Michael Flynn to provide information on others. So not only is the legal piece, we get a window into how aggressively that's moving, but there's the political side of this as well. And that's going to stiffen the spine of even Republicans now who are investigating this in both the Senate and the House to get to the bottom of it.
And Asha, you've been part of investigations. I mean, Paul Manafort's the top of the pyramid. I guess the only one above him in theory would be then candidate, now President Trump. Paul Manafort was the campaign chairman. So the fact that they are focused on him has pretty severe implications.
Yes, definitely. Well, it seems to me, given the pressure that is on him and the fact that they are looking at all of these crimes and are willing to charge him in court, that they believe that he is essentially some kind of hub in any kind of agreement or activity that was going on between the Russians and anyone else here in the United States, whether or not they were connected to the campaign. So I think that he holds the key, and that's what they want to know. And it's probably also why he's being very reluctant. And I think that, you know, the tactics that are being used are probably being used because he's not being as forthcoming as they would like him to be, and they need to go in and do it more aggressively.
Yeah, that's an interesting possibility. We'll get into that much more coming up. All right, Jeffrey, Asha, David, thank you very, very much.